Yes, sir.
All right. Session T8, CPUs, or central processing units. For the objectives of this one, we're going to describe various types of processors and be able to articulate how to select a processor to match the system's needs. Identify the CPU as the central processing unit and explain its purpose and the requirements of keeping it functioning. Basic maintenance, things you can do. We're going to be able to look at and choose appropriate cooling methods we can use and see a variety of different types that are available to us. And name the steps of replacing and installing a processor in your computer. Identify the common pitfalls when installing a processor, like one of the ones we talked about, dropping the processor chip and bending the pins. And given a set of symptoms, identify common CPU problems and describe how to solve them. Adaptability seems to keep coming up because we definitely want to be able to react to any given situation with regards to troubleshooting, being able to learn more and be able to solve more problems as we go along. And in technology, growth mindset is critical because things are always changing. We're always developing new technologies. We're always seeing new things, and we have to be aware of them and be able to advise our company on things that might be beneficial to them, as well as when our company brings new technologies in, we should have at least a familiarity with them so that we can know how to work on them. Yes, Amber.
Quick question. It might be dumb, but the BSMs, are these for our knowledge, like what we will need to, like how we will need to think and move when we have to deal with, like, the CPU, or like, will this be on a test as well?
Well, the BSMs is more of a lifestyle. You're trying to develop these lifestyles. It's not just the technical skills. You know, the technical skills, yeah, they are valuable, but the BSMs, the adaptability, growth mindset, teamwork, communication, all that stuff is going to definitely help you be more successful within your career paths. So we do try to incorporate and apply them whenever possible into the lessons as we are working on them. Because it takes about 2 months to develop a habit. So go ahead and start instituting those habits now. This is a 3-month course, gives you time to start, you know, building those habits up in your life. So by the time you get through, they become more of a natural thing. Did you have something, Ashton?
No.
Okay. There we go. All right. Types and characteristics of processors. We kind of got over, we went over this just a little bit earlier on. The central processing unit is the central brain of the computer. It is installed directly into the motherboard. It is probably the most identifiable piece in the geography of the motherboard. And it is the main determining factor to set the computing power of your system. There are two major manufacturers, Intel and AMD. And each of these manufacturers have many different types of chips that have evolved over the past few years. And each of them show different characteristics. Like we were talking about yesterday, what is the difference between an Intel and an AMD physically?
The pin formats. One of them has the PGA, that the AMD. The other one has the inline. I forgot the name though.
All right. I didn't hear it. There we go. Emmanuel dropped it. LGA for Intel. So land grid array.
Man, are y'all using my cool, what you call them? LGA, Intel GA?
Every day, Marvin.
EGA, MD. Y'all got to use these quick, these things, man. I'm telling you. Go ahead, Kelly.
All right. Intel CPUs. They use desktop, laptop processors, and they're sold under Core, Pentium, and Celeron brands. Those are the main brands that they operate under. They are extremely low power, and they are the higher end of the two. And they also have a performance-based chip called a Xeon. Some laptop processors are packaged in the Centrino technology, which is, you know, an interconnected processor and the chipsets, and they have a wireless adapter in one unit to improve laptop performance. So some of that stuff's already built in to the technology. Here's the essential evolution of the processors. So they went from the 4-bit, which if you could actually imagine that, back in the 1970s, operating off of 4-bit, then you get up to the 16-bit in the late 70s, and then 32, which was where we started seeing more modern operating systems, similar to Windows, I think Windows 3.1, 3.2, and then moving all the way up through 95 and up to the modern era. And then it was around the mid to late 90s, we started seeing the Pentium processors. They were all the rage when they came out. They were absolutely, you know, the best what you were looking for if you were into gaming or any kind of heavy computing. And they offered a 32-bit and a 64-bit version around that time. And then they started getting into multi-core processors around early to mid 2000s. And then they had the Intel Core 2. And then now they're starting to get into the most recent generation, which are the 64-bit processors, which is like i3, i5, i7s. Now, the nice thing is if you have one of these nice new Core i3, 5s, or 7s, and you're still wanting to operate off of a 32-bit operating system, it can do that. It will accommodate you. You just won't be utilizing it to its fullest capacity, but you can't go the other way. You obviously cannot use a 64-bit operating system on a 32-bit processor. Now, main thing with the chips, you do want to remember the naming groups, the Pentium, Celeron and all that, and know that will guide you. The i9, i3, i5, i7, that is a naming type for Intel chips. Have that in the back of your mind. That is, you know, when you hear those names, that will guide you in that direction. And the Centrino. All right. AMDs, or Advanced Micro Devices. They're pretty popular, relatively popular in the gaming communities because they do work pretty well. They're less expensive than the Intels. And recently, I think in the last 5 or so years, Intel did surpass them within the gaming community. And AMD has been regaining ground, I think, with the Ryzen 9. They use the different sockets than Intel. So there is, you know, a different motherboard, as we were talking about the LGA and the PGA. So you need to make sure which motherboard type you have to match up with the processors you're going to use. And then the naming families that they have for the AMD chips are FX, Phenom, Athlon, Sempron. And then they have the Athlon, Turion, V-Series, Phenom, Sempron, for laptops, and then now recently they have the Ryzens. So they tend to break, most companies will tend to break down their chips into essentially the value segment, which is your baseline, and then they'll go up to a mainstream segment, which is a, you know, common, you know, average user, and then you will, you know, move up to the prosumer, which is, you know, a little bit more advanced. You start getting into graphics design and stuff like that, and then moving into gaming segment, which is extremely high performance. Interestingly, AMD, a couple generation of chips ago, somebody in their higher ups thought they came up with a really brilliant idea. they were sitting there saying, you know what? It costs a lot of money to run four different manufacturing types of chips and running four different lines of these chips. Why don't we just make one chip? That's all we're going to make, just one chip. But we're still going to sell four different types. And we're just going to essentially put governors on the motherboards and in the software that makes it act like it's a value or a mainstream segment or a gaming chip. So depending on how much you pay, the software will limit how much processing power you're able to get out of the chip. But what do you think happened real quick after they released that chip?
People learn to take the governors off.
Exactly. Gaming community, notorious for this kind of stuff. They realized real fast, all you had to do was buy the cheap end chip and you could overclock it up to a gaming performance and essentially get a really high-end chip, you know, availability for a very, very inexpensive price. And so as a result, AMD didn't sell many of their higher-end chips. So as of the generation after that, they went back to breaking it down into multi-layered chip manufacturing.
I can speak on this.
Okay.
So, as you see before you, this is the information about the PC that I brought back to life. And if you guys can tell, this is the your system page. It tells you what type of operating system that you have and some information about that PC. So I want everybody to open their eyes and I want them to tell me some interesting things that you can pick out from this slide. What should jump off the page for you? Or what's jumping off the page for you?
The amount of RAM it has, but the amount that's usable.
I like that, Jermaine. That's one. And we'll talk about that, but that's exactly I like where you are. Anybody else can help out, Jermaine, point out some other stuff?
The dual processor core unit.
Good. That's good. Emmanuel, OS, Cliff, right? Chris, what did you say, sir?
I said processing unit.
Processing
the
unit.
The processor. My bad.
With the dual core. Okay. Y'all, everybody's on there. So when you pull up the system page, you are looking for operating system. You're looking for what type of processor that's in there and what is the system type, which is if it's a 64 or 32. In the name of my processor, it says AMD Athlon 64-bit. So, but the Windows 7 operating system that I have, the professional, it was only a 32-bit operating system. I'm literally holding my PC back because it can do more, but it's held back by the operating system, which I didn't need to say because I wanted somebody to say that. So being that it's a 32-bit operating system, what is that holding back? What's being held back by 32-bit operating system? That's my next question.
The amount of RAM that's available for you to use.
Frankie, you're on it. That's it. Thank you, Emmanuel. My computer can hold more. The motherboard has slots for more, but the operating system can only use so much dealing with that particular 32-bit operating system. So I had to do some upgrades in order to unleash the full capability of my PC. That's what you're seeing right here. This is what Miss Jackie can go to on her computer to look at and then base it off of the manufacturer specs or one of those sites that I put up the other day to find out the, like Emmanuel said, the capacity of how much RAM you can add and if it's a 32-bit versus a 64-bit operating system. That's what's going on here. And as Kelly, it's still up here. Go ahead and go to the next slide, Kelly. Hopefully I got it, the other one up right next to it. It's in here. Okay. I'm talking, let me talk. This is a different picture. This is a picture that we had yesterday, and Jermaine kind of helped us out with that mouse. Like it says on the South Bridge, it's It's not as necessary to have, because it's a simple device, it's not necessary to move as quick as that graphics card, which is AGP and PCI Express, as well as those RAM slots that we talked about. And what's the purpose of the memory controller hub? MCH. What's going on there? Remember that picture that we had yesterday? What happens there? What is its purpose? Kelly described it as a... Go ahead, someone. I think somebody was speaking.
I think it's prioritize the jobs.
Look at the word he used. Mogus is all over it. Prioritize. That's it. Kelly, we tried to make it, it's like a traffic director. It makes, it ensures what needs to go next, what needs to go last, what can wait, what has to happen now. Mogus, you're right on it. It's all about prioritization there. You can keep going, Kelly. I'm gonna step off. I'm gonna let you do this one. Still muted, sir.
All right. Basically, inside you have inside an actual processor, you have all these little things. You have the controller unit, which is essentially just directing traffic inside the actual processor going to what you need to get taken care of. You have an internal memory cache that's gonna, you know, operate essentially like a short-term memory unit. And then you have the registers, which are typically operating the, doing the actual processing. And then you have the input-output unit, which is functioning for basically receiving and sending out information. Does anybody off the top of their heads know what the ALU is?
It's an arithmetic logic unit.
The what? I'm sorry, I couldn't hear you.
Arithmetic and logic unit.
All right, yeah. Arithmetic logic unit. It's a digital circuit inside the processor, and actually performs algorithmic and logical operations within the actual CPU. This is just kind of trying to give you a 10,000 foot view of what it looks like inside the actual processor. So here we go, breaking it down. It basically, the input output is the messenger. It allows stuff going in and out, control unit, all activities inside the processor, like the traffic director, as we were talking about, and logical computations and everything handled inside the arithmetic logic unit, and registers, small holding areas, you know, on it just to kind of store information until the actual ALU needs it. And then the internal memory cache is kind of like the cache in your computer when you're reaching out to the internet. You know, every time you type in Google on your machine, you're not necessarily going all the way out to Google. You're typically going to a more localized proxy server, which is going to bring up the most recent version of that website that you were looking at. And then the buses are the little lines that are connecting everything together. Any questions with regards to that?
A mouthful, but Kelly just pretty much said, just like we just talked about the North Bridge and the memory controller hub and how Mogus referred to it. Is prioritization is happening everywhere. And yeah. Hopefully we'll give you a picture. You can kind of see all the little transistors and things there, but prioritization is happening everywhere. And this is the process in which how that happens. Importance here, just know that it's not just a big chip and it's shiny. It's stuff on the other side of it, that chip that's doing things, that's allowing it to be effective.
And almost at every level of a computer system, you're gonna have some form of cache memory. And that is essentially just to kind of speed things up. You know, like if you're working in an office and you know, you tend to break your computer on a regular basis and you have to call IT 3 times a week, rather than going into the company directory, looking up IT, trying to figure out who you talked to the last time and doing all that, every time you may put a sticky note on the side of your computer, which essentially would be like a cache memory of that information that you need. So it's readily available, it's there, it's handy. And then if the person you normally talk to gets promoted or leaves the company, you'd replace that with the new person that you would talk to. So you're updating your cache memory. So any questions with regards to just the basic internal architecture? All right. Now, when you're going to select your CPUs, some factors you need to take into account would be the clock speed of the processor versus the clock speed of what your actual motherboard can handle. The restrictions with regards to architecture or form factor, can it fit? Memory cache, you know, obviously the socket type, are you using the right chipset and processor? I mean, are you using an Intel chip on a AMD board? Multi-processing capabilities, you know, dual processors, multi-core, multi-threading. These are all things that you're gonna wanna take into account. And, you know, do the CPUs, do they offer support for virtualization if that's something that you're gonna wanna do? And do they have integrated graphics and then as well as security? But we'll kind of dive into all of these as we go as well. All right, clock speed. What sets the clock speed?
Nice, Kelly.
CMOS.
Quartz.
Quartz.
Quartz crystal.
Clock.
It's right there up top. Sets the clock speed. And as we were talking about with RAM, remember yesterday we were talking about RAM, where it would essentially, instead of just operating at each pulse of the clock, it would operate at, you know, if you did a double data rate, it would operate at 2 times per clock speed. And then we double it again and it operates at 4 times per clock cycle. Double it again, operates at 8 times per clock cycle. Same thing happens with chipsets and, you know, and its interactions with the motherboard. And we call that clock multiplier, so that they can run several processors each time, you know, for each cycle of the clock, they can run several bits at a time, rather than just running a single set for each clock cycle. For some reason, the 32-bit processors are known as x86 processors, and I believe that's because they became mainstream in 1986. I'm guessing that's why they do it.
Correct.
But
Correct, you're right. We have to look it up just to confirm that. Yeah.
32-bit processors are known as x86, and they can only handle 32-bit operating systems. And 64s are known as x64 because of the 64-bit. So why they changed the naming standard, I have no idea. But that's something to kind of keep in the back of your mind, because sometimes they do use that in folder notation when you're dealing with operating systems. A 32-bit operating system will show up as an x86 operating system, and then a 64 will be as an x64. Hybrid processors will show up as x86/64, and they can handle either. AMD was the first one to put one of these out. And Intel almost knocked AMD off the map shortly after this with coming up with multi-threading or multi-processing. And this is a wonderful technology. It allows that, you know, the CPU to basically handle two different operating threads at a single time. And in essence, a single processor is acting like two. And so sometimes when you're looking at the cores on your computer, if you want to see how many cores your computer is running, if you have a quad core and it has multi-threading, it will look as if you have 8 cores, because you essentially have, you have the 4 main ones, but they're still being able to operate as each one as 2. So instead of 4, it will look like you have 8. This was an amazing jump in technology, allowing much faster processing time. And it was a while before AMD actually was able to catch up on this. I believe, yeah, it says down here, 2017 was when AMD was finally able to do multi-processing. So, inside your CPUs, essentially you would have, if you have like the actual main CPU chip, what used to be, it was a single core, single CPU chip. Now, essentially you have, you know, in this one, it's a four core or quad core. It has four CPUs essentially in a single unit operating as a single piece. Now, if you're gonna do something like virtualization, this is where it kind of gets neat. If you have a quad core processor with multi-threading technology, you can essentially set up, you can have one core be the operating system, the main operating system, and then you can run seven other virtual machines. So you can have a virtual machine essentially for each core within that computer. And so when you're looking for in an office setting, when they're trying to set up like virtual machines and you're running virtual desktops and things like that, they're looking for, you know, CPUs with as many cores as absolutely possible so they can run as many virtual machines on that system as they can.
Quick question. Let's see here. Cliff, what is hyper-threading, sir? I want to make sure we follow along. Can you explain hyper-threading for us?
Multi-threading. I'm trying to think how to explain it.
If you can't, I'm gonna. But this is a big thing. I want to make sure we're on. Amber, you put your hand up. Go ahead, give it a chance. Appreciate you, Cliff. Give it a chance, Amber. How would you explain it?
I want to say it makes like two units act like one.
Reverse it.
No, you're right. It is one. It acts like two.
It exactly. It will double the performance because it's making a single core or one core design and function as its two cores, which is hyper-threading, which a multi-threading, which is allowing more performance to happen based off that technology. I just want to make sure that's a thing. We want to make sure that everybody grasps that before we keep moving. So this picture right here, if Kelly would put his mouse over each core, got one, two, three, four, and on the actual backside of that piece, on the backside of that CPU, put it over there as well so they can see where it's located. So one, two, three, and four. It's a quad core processor. Before this technology that we're talking about, it was just a very good processor, quad core. Now with that technology, we turn that quad core and make it perform as if it has eight cores due to the hyper-threading, multi-threading processes. So imagine how much performance you gain by being able to do that with this newfound technology. So that's major. And the reason that's major, because Kelly just mentioned it, and I'm just saying it in a different way, we have virtual machines. That's when you have one computer that can run different operating systems on it simultaneously as if it's a different unit. So, and that processing power from those cores make that happens effortlessly. So depending on what type of environment you're in, having more multi-cores can really impact your business or impact the system that you're working in. I just wanted to reiterate that, Kelly, but go ahead, you got it now.
Has anybody ever used a Chromebook? Okay, so essentially a Chromebook doesn't really have a full functioning operating system on it. It reaches out to a server and talks to that server, and it's operating essentially off of that server utilizing that operating system. That's why they're basically saying you have to have internet access to it to get full utilization of your operating system. So what it's doing is it's reaching out, and then it will use one of these cores on a server. And that core will be dedicated to being your operating system while you're utilizing it. Now, if we go back, so inside this whole unit right here, which is you're going to be your, technically your CPU, you have, as we were just talking, you have four little CPUs in each one of these. And then if we go back real quick and look at the architecture, inside of each of those four, each of those four chips has this architecture inside of each of those four chips. So each one of these, like this block here, is the equivalent of just one of these inside the CPU. You have your hand up, DJ.
Yeah, I was just wondering, like when I was in high school, like middle school through high school, they had given like all their students Chromebooks as like as an experiment for kids to have laptops or something. But yeah, we had all gotten Chromebooks, and when I had first got it, I had actually gotten into mine, and I put the Linux I put Linux on it.
Okay.
And, most people weren't able to figure out how to do it they weren't able to understand how I did it. To tell the truth, I didn't really even understand. So, but you said that Chromebooks don't.
Remember when we were talking about yesterday when you go into the BIOS and you're setting up your BIOS boot order?
Yeah.
And it's going, what it's doing is it's going through that checklist looking for, first we want you to go to the internet. When you go to the internet, you're going to go to this proxy server. We're going to give you an address. You go to that address, it essentially authorizes itself here. Boom, here's your desktop. Here's your operating system that you're going to function from. If you did not have internet access, there still is a very, very low level base operating system on the Chromebook. It has to be there. So there is that base level operating system that's sitting there. And so it would be able to do minimal functionality.
Yeah.
Now, Linux is one of those fun things where it doesn't take up a whole lot of space. I mean, you can literally just throw Linux on a thumb drive and operate Linux completely off of a thumb drive. I don't know if that's what you did or if you actually...
Yeah, that's exactly what I did.
In the actual memory of the computer, because it does have minimal storage on there, not a ton. But there's a little bit there for cache memory, RAM, and all that fun stuff, to use for virtual memory, all that fun stuff. So you did it off of a thumb drive?
Yeah.
Yeah, so you're essentially creating almost a Linux emulator from a thumb drive and booting. And so instead of going to the internet, you're booting from that thumb drive and then running the operating system from the thumb drive.
Okay.
So that's basically what had happened.
Hey, DJ, you broke all the rules, man. You... going in there messing with the property of the school and stuff like that.
Yeah.
What school system was that? We got to report this, man. You can't come in here and...
it was a long time ago, so it's like...
The statute of limitations must be up. Okay, I got you.
You're safe. When I was in middle school. I'm 23 now, man. It's too late.
You're safe. All right.
I don't know, man. They have long memories. All right. Three different levels of memory cache within the actual processor. So, as we were saying, in almost every stage, there is some version of cache memory, be it with internally in the actual processors. And then you would have the motherboard, like the CPU itself would have a cache memory right outside. The North Bridge kind of has its own little cache memory. It's all these little pockets of memory set around to kind of help speed these processes up, because you don't want to keep requesting information every single time you need it. You want to be able to hold on to at least a little bit amount of that memory, you know, so if, especially if it's something you're going to be using repeatedly over and over again. So within the CPU, they have three different layers or levels of cache, and they do like to talk about this on the actual A plus. They will say, you know, which type of cache memory would this fall under, and they would give you a basic example of this. First one you have is the level one cache, which is absolutely the smallest level of cache. There isn't really that much, and each core would have their own cache, and this is actually physically on the actual processor itself. So it's physically attached. It is absolutely the fastest. It doesn't have a lot of storage space on it, and it is by far the most expensive because of the fact that it is physically attached to that processor in that in the individual core. So if we go back here, where's that picture? Nope, did I do that? There we go. Click the wrong button. All right, so if you go back here, so let's view this, you know, each of these as like a little processor. Put my annotator up here. So the level one cache would be like right on this processor. It's like right there. So it's physically attached to that individual processor. Like I said, it is not very big. There's not a whole lot of space there, but it is absolutely the fastest because of that direct connection. It's right there. And each processor will have its own level one cache built right into it.
Everybody know what cache is, correct? If you don't, make a noise, shake your head, thumbs down. If you need a good definition.
Okay.
Okay.
So, smallest, fastest, most expensive to produce. Now, then we go to level two cache, which is a little bit bigger. And it sits just outside the processor. It's a little bit more storage space. Little less expensive than the level one, but it's also a little slower. And each processor has its own level two cache. So it sits, like I said, just right outside of it. So not as expensive as level one, not as fast either. And it sits right outside. Each processor has its own. Now, we go up to level three cache, which is, of the three, it's the least expensive, it's the slowest, the largest, and in this example, since we have four processor, it is shared by all the cores. So it's, you know, a little bit larger. The processor doesn't need to reach outside the actual chip to find any additional cache memory. It's able to store things there very short term, especially if it's going to, you know, continually ask for this information. And it sits right outside all four processors. So level three is shared by all four chips in this particular example. If it was an 8-core, it would be shared by all 8. So does everybody understand the three levels of cache memory within the central processing units? Erase it here.
It's a good visual coming up, so you'll see it.
All right. So the shared cache we just talked about, and almost all current CPUs have an integrated memory controller, IMC, included in the processor. And this is essentially like it's an internal, you know, traffic manager that kind of helps the data and move faster to determine where it needs to go to be able to have the most efficient processing, and allows for significant increase in performance. It's not letting me admit. There we go. So here is a pretty good visual example of the three levels. So here's your cores, your four cores like we were talking about. You have the level ones attached to each processor physically on it. And it's a lower level amount of cache as far as volume, but higher in speed and cost. Level two, middle ground, right off of each processor, but each processor has their own level two cache. And then you have the level three cache, which is shared by all four processors in this particular example. And then the memory controller helps determine who gets to go where and when to get maximum efficiency. Any questions so far with this? All right. All right, security. Within a lot of these processors, they kind of have some base level security built into them. I believe it was an Intel has the XD, which means execute disable. And then you have the NX, which means non-executable. And it works with the operating system to designate, you know, an error, like where to hold instructions. And when these areas are designated for these instructions stored, they are not able to be executing, thus preventing buffer overflow attacks. Marvin, can you give me a second?
I'm all over it, man. Hey, tell my guy
said. Yeah, I apologize.
Tell my guy said hello. So basically, this was brought into play due to, we can say, hackers and things of that nature. You have an ability to address malicious software on a CPU level. And that's really big, because if your computer can stop it before it gets started, we're ahead of the curve. So that's really, really significant. And this is what this slide is saying. Also, if you notice, it can be enabled either using the UEFI or the BIOS. So it's it doesn't have to have the neat GUI interface like the UEFI, like we talked about. And that's the last slide, because this is just letting you know that security is based on that slide. Even though the EBD can stop malware from executing, it cannot remove it. So that malware is still there, and you still need to do some work, but you will be notified and alarmed that something has tried to happen, and now you have to address it. And that's half the battle. And it's not 100% effective, because hackers are getting smarter every day. So this is something that's always trying to evolve. Move on to this next one. Virtualization and integrated graphics. Maybe it didn't move because I'm trying to move the wrong one. Here we go. I got you. I was moving the preview. All right. Let's see here. Avery, if you don't mind, sir, I want you to read. Let's change some voices up here.
All right. Virtualization and integrated graphics. So, support for virtualization. A computer can use software to create and manage multiple virtual machines and their virtual devices. Most processors sold today support virtualization, and the feature must be enabled in the UEFI/BIOS setup. Integrated graphics. A processor might include an integrated GPU. A graphics processing unit, GPU, is a processor that manipulates graphic data to form the images on a monitor screen. The GPU might be on a video card, on the motherboard, or embedded in the CPU package. When inside the CPU package, it is called integrated graphics. Many AMD processors and all the Intel second generation and higher processors have integrated graphics.
Steve, are you available, sir? I want to talk to my people that's built on some computers here. Steve, okay, let's see who else is in here. Emmanuel, why is it important to have integrated graphics? What? Give me a scenario when integrated graphics come in handy.
So like right now with the GPU shortage, it will allow you to build a computer without having to get a GPU.
And that wasn't even my answer, but that's a very good. I wasn't even thinking that way, Emmanuel. So hats off to you. That is good.
It can also allow you to move between the dedicated graphics and the integrated graphics to save on power or resources or whatever.
That's also a very good one. Man, stop talking. Let somebody else, because you're not even, you're saying things I like, but you're not even hitting the point that I want, but I'm going to hold those because those are really good. So good job on that. Avery, go ahead, sir.
So I built my computer and my wife's computer.
Okay.
And so like I play video games, so I needed a graphics card. So when I built mine, I paid good money to get like a good graphics card. Right. But when I was building my wife's, she just needed a computer to, you know, do schoolwork, watch YouTube videos, you know, very basic things that everyone does. And she doesn't need a graphics card for that. So I got her a CPU that had integrated graphics, you know, because that's all she needs.
And so price wise, you didn't have to spend to create that experience for her. She was right. Able to, and that's also a good thing. So we looked at cost. Emmanuel told us about the ability to address how it performance wise. My whole thing was when I was playing around with that computer that I have, I added an additional graphics card because it gave my computer the opportunity to not have to just use VGA and use HDMI, but it also improved the graphics too, of course. But my issue was I couldn't get it to work. And if you can't get it to work, like Emmanuel kind of mentioned, the fact that it's already built on and you can use your computer before you get your new nice graphics card working, I'm trying to toggle. If I didn't have it to work, I couldn't get that computer to turn on to use it. So I would be dead in the water or if I couldn't get that graphics card and get those drivers updated. So having that ability to still navigate is the most important thing that comes along. So if you ever have to go to use safe mode, your new nice card may not be functional because it's going down to the bare bones and it's going to go to that integrated graphics to perform that safe mode environment. So that's the significance of it. And I'm happy that Intel realized that it's necessary and AMD is on board as well. But having integrated graphics come in handy when things are happening bad on your PC and you need to use a safe mode environment because your nice graphic card may not be allowed to be used in those environments if you don't allow it. So, but good job, Avery. And of course, good job, Emmanuel. And we talked about VM. Kelly mentioned it just a minute ago, the virtualization. If your computer has those cores and you're trying to set up a virtualization environment and you can't, 9 times out of 10 is because you didn't turn it on in your BIOS. It's like a little check mark or on and off. You have to enable it in order for your computer to successfully perform those those tasks and create that environment. All right, I think we got some sockets that we need to look at. All right, is William in here? I don't think William, I think he said he was gonna be a little late today. So we got the PIN grid array, we got the LGA LAN grid array, and you see a little dollop of daisy right there. So that's gonna be your thermal paste. But I gotta ask, at this point we need to know now. Let's see, I'm gonna mess with somebody that I think might, Carlos, are you available, sir?
Yes.
Okay, LGA, it belongs to what CPU manufacturer?
I don't know, but I think I'm going to go with Intel.
Well, good guess, sir. Intel, LGA, exactly. Intel, GA, Intel. Also, should be recognizable by the landing grid that you see. And the pins will be on the socket. Pin grid array, PGAMD. PGAMD. I just wanted to make sure that you knew that. This picture is showing the amount of actual thermal paste is located on top of your CPU before you adhere the fan and the heat sink for the cooling of your CPU. Emmanuel probably would say now, and some others, maybe even Avery with the new computers that he built, you may have to use that dollop of it's an eraser size of thermal paste. Why wouldn't you have to use it on some of the newer processors? Let me make sure I say this right. Okay, DJ, go ahead. What would be a reason why I would not have to use it?
Different types of cooling, like maybe water cooling or a better fan.
I see where you're going with it. You'll still need it. Emmanuel put it inside the chat. A lot of the new processors may come with a layer of thermal paste already applied, and you just got to pull the plastic off the top of it and then adhere your heat sink and your fan. They already have it there. They know it's necessary, so they'll have it already there on top, because if not properly applied, you can run into some heating and some cooling issues. So it kind of makes sure that on the CPU, on the cooler, you're right, Emmanuel, it's already there. So it makes it so that process is more streamlined. So you may not have to use it, but say for instance, a couple years down the line, you want to check, it has become brittle. That's the amount that you'll use to adhere it to your heat sink. It's not a lot at all. It's just they call it maybe a pencil eraser size. Mm-hmm. Okay, another fun fact. How would you remove it? Let's say, for instance, you do have, it's brittle, and you want to clean, you want to take it, you want to dislodge your processor, your CPU away from your heat sink. What is a method of trying to separate the two? It's if it doesn't come apart easily. I'm going to tell you because I forgot myself, but a little hack is, okay, Avery said a soap, wet rag, maybe like some alcohol to help. How about some floss? Dental floss can be wedged in between to help dislodge the power supply, the heat sink and fan away from that CPU. And then you can clean it off with some alcohol in order to remove all of the dry, cracky, old thermal paste before you apply a new layer. And let's let it be known, Avery was joking, but yes. And then we may have a question. You may see a question about that how can you remove the heating source away from the cooling source away from that CPU? Just some dental floss.
Make sure it's non-wax floss. Like that. Just regular floss, and then it can cut through the paste and dislodge it pretty easily. Don't grab and twist.
There you go.
Ends, all that fun stuff, which will cause damage to the actual unit. Right here, here's the socket names that match up with the chips for Intel. Remember we were saying it used to be you had to remember every chip type and every socket type and how they marry up. Nowadays, don't have to do that. So, but you do need to kind of understand the naming methodologies, which is why we were saying, you know, with the Intel Celerons and Avalons, stuff like that, you have to remember the naming types for the chips, and then like the Ryzens for AMD, and then what the socket names would be. So for Intel, their sockets tend to start with an LGA. So each one starts with an LGA. So whenever you see LGA, you know right off the top of the, you know, top of your head that that is a Intel socket. So does that make sense to everybody? So LGA, land grid array. Land grid array is Intel. Intel, their socket names are LGA. So, hold, sorry, hold on. My little one takes two things in life very seriously. One is naps, one is food, and we're having a food issue. So,
all over. Let me go to the next slide because it's very important. Now, you guys keep in mind, do you think we expect you to remember all these numbers? Yes, no. In all honesty, there may be one or two questions that kind of lean into those numbers. The goal is to understand, in most cases, as that number gets bigger, the processor kind of gets a little better in most cases. That's not going to be the case all the time. But just keep in mind, LGA gives you and gets you into the Intel environment, and that may be the way that you differentiate your answer versus some of the AMD ones. And now we got some sockets. Look at all those pins there. You guys see them? It's so many pins. And we use this acronym, which is ZIF, Z-I-F. Someone tells me what ZIF mean, and then I'll get to you, William. Who remember what ZIF stands for?
Zero insertion force.
Zero insertion force. Thank you, Mogus. And knowing now what that means, how does that play into what you're looking at right now? Someone else, not Mogus. Hearing zero insertion force. Frank, go ahead.
You put the processor in there? You want to use zero first insertion force?
If you place the processor in there correctly, look at that slide. Do you guys see there's typically a telltale sign on the chip itself? There will be like a little corner where it highlights where it starts and where it should sit. And if you line it up appropriately, there's no need for any force. It should just sit right on top. And when you pull the lever down to lock it in, because if you notice, a lot of them have little levers, have a little hook on the arm on all of those. It locks right back on top of that into that motherboard without any type of effort. The only effort you have is to pull it down and to lock it down on there. So it should be very easy to do. It shouldn't be hard. It shouldn't be something that's requiring a lot of effort. If that's the case, it may not be aligned correctly. So you want to make sure that is aligned correctly. Hey, Will.
Hey, what's going on, Mr. Kane? Would you be so kind and be able to drop in the...
Oh, yeah, I got you. I didn't even think about that. It's in chat. We'll make sure you get to it. But that's what these are showing you. And if you also notice, as that number kind of got higher, thank you, Kelly or Diego, I don't know who writing on there, but thank you. As the number got higher, the amount of pins that you see have also gotten more significant. Have you noticed that? Look at the LG A775 versus the 1150 or the 2011. It's so many more pins. And William, it's like perfect timing. What does that even mean? What are all those pins? What does that help with? What's going on there?
Well, the more the pins, the more the smaller the micro.
The connections between the chip and the motherboard, is going to be an ideal improvement performance. We're dealing with performance. That yes. Triangle equals pin one. Kelly put that in on the slide, and that's what I kind of tried to allude to. I was hoping I saw it on there, but I didn't. Appreciate you, Frank.
Any reversible connector or anything that can go in multiple ways, they will typically always put a triangle on it, which will indicate pin one. That is for almost any connector you have on a computer. They will use that symbol to indicate it.
Sure will. All right. We just went through LGA. It's time to go to his cousin, AMD, whenever it moves. Kelly, you're back?
Yeah, I'm pretty well back.
If not, man, you know I'm here.
So AMD, their sockets, the names they use for their sockets all start with FM or AM, and it's the way we kind of remembered it was the old time radios. AM, FM are the two different bands you can operate off of. So AM, AMD, FM tends to be your socket types until you get further up, and they will have the AM3s. So as we were stating, originally we had to memorize, or they had to memorize, this was actually the version before I came in, they had to memorize every single chip and every single socket, which ones went with which. Now, it's mostly you just need to understand the naming type. So when you get an AMD chip, you look for an FM socket or an AM socket. So when you get an Intel chip, you would get like the i9 or something like that for the chip. And then you would look for the LGA for the actual socket itself. Are there any questions with regards to the chips and their corresponding sockets?
Emmanuel and Steve brought up a good point in chat. And we are aware, and if you're in kind of embedded in the industry, you'll know a lot of these chipsets that you're looking at, a lot of these processors that you're looking at, they're on the older side because the test that we are getting you prepared for has not been revamped to have the newer CPU. So you may not see Ryzen, which is AMD's baby right now, or you may not see some of the higher end Intels, which is the Lakes, I think. Maybe it's the Lakes or the Mountains. I don't know, Whiskey Lake, Crystal Lake, somebody. What's the lake that Jason comes out of?
Any lake, apparently, because that guy just jumps out of anywhere. Could be his mom, apparently, too.
Hey, whatever. But yeah, God, appreciate it, Diego. But yes. Those are the newer puppies. Those are the newer ones on the block. Let that not deter you, because this is still kind of things that you need to know, because you may still see these in the field. But the test hasn't been revamped, so we got to use what we have right now to keep moving. So
yeah, next FYI. I believe it is next year the A+ will be revamped in 2022.
Yeah, and we just need to understand it. It doesn't matter. If I know what a Mustang is, a Mustang is a Mustang. I don't care what's the latest model. A Mustang is a Mustang. Therefore, as long as we understand what each thing that we're going to learn here, which is, you know, memory, CPUs, and the variances of these actual types of models between a Winnebago and an actual, you know, what do you call the one with the wings? Anybody know who's the one with the wings? No, it's the one with the wings. The opens up suicide doors. I'll give you that much of a clue. Never seen it in a shop or broken down. I'll give you that much of a clue.
DeLorean.
No, you're close, but it's a very rich man's car. You have to actually be certified. No, anybody could. Ferrari, you have to be approved to buy it. There we go. Royce. Oh. There he is. Royce. You have to actually be approved to buy that car. I don't care how much money you have, but do you have the statue to actually be riding in this car?
How about that, man? I did not know that. Look, yeah. Dago on Fridays dropping little nuggets, man.
Useless information as always. That's what I'm here for. Don't worry about it.
We appreciate it. I was like, because the Tesla has it now. The Tesla SUV has it now. And it dances. So just like Intel, you're looking at these slots again. And just getting a visual of what you see before you place it down into the socket on the motherboard. AM3 plus, FM1, FM2, just a visual. One thing I guess you can see is AM3 doesn't have the middle cut out there. You see that? And also you see the little blocks that's blocking some of the pinholes. All of that lets you know that it goes down one way. And if you try to go down a different way, then you're gonna bend a pin. So just keep that in mind. Be very careful. What is it? Measure twice, cut once. Measure three times on this. Like, just be super careful. You don't want
to. There's one thing that's really cute about this, and I don't know why they did it. But if you look at FM1 and you look at the right top right, there's an actual rectangle that's there. If you count the amount of holes between that and it is one for the FM1, and believe it or not, for the FM2, it is actually two. Oh, wait. Don't ask me how I notice these things. This is how ridiculous my brain works. And this is how it comes up with this logic. So you guys see that rectangle there on the upper right-hand corner? Inside the middle. Look at the middle. There's a big hole. Now, on the right-hand corner, there's a rectangle that does not touch. It is exactly one dot away.
Oh, I see.
While the FM2 is actually two dots away from it.
Yeah, I see it. And on top of that,
I lost you.
Diego, Kelly, if you go all the way down to the AM plus bottom left corner, you see that little triangle that Kelly was talking about.
Yeah, that's there.
And then if you go over to the middle one, same corner, all the rest of them are cut off. That one's a square. It's a square on that one. And all the other three corners are, what is that? Like, just a
triangle.
Yeah, triangle.
So that white triangles on the edges.
That's your pin. That kind of pin one there too as well. So.
And it's all the same color, but I believe if you zoom in, they actually have a triangle there as well.
Okay, yeah.
You can't see it, though.
Can't see it because of the picture, color. But yeah, I think there's a triangle right there, which indicates pin one.
And either which way, they always cut the corner weird on the wherever pin one is. That side always has like a weird cutout. It's missing more pins than any other end.
And typically they'll have a notch as well, like a little notch.
A white dot, something. Yeah, on the chip itself, you're right.
Physical orientation of how the chip's supposed to set in there. And if it doesn't go in easy, don't make it.
That's it.
Not going to comment.
Managing CPU heat. I think as we talked about a little earlier, CPU can go from like room temperature to over 500 degrees in just over 2 seconds. So we actually have to have a way of dissipating that heat and dispersing it so that the chip doesn't get so hot that it actually damages itself. So there's actually a couple different ways we can do this. You actually have heat sinks, which look like this, like little blades sticking up into the air. And then you have cooling fans, there's liquid cooling, there's actually submersion where you can actually put the entire computer down into liquid, and various ways that we can actually go about doing this. If you're just using a heat sink and nothing else, that's considered what they call passive cooling. You're kind of just letting that heat radiate out those blades, and then whatever air is like passing across it will help disperse enough heat so that it doesn't damage the product. You typically will see this around the north bridge right here. And other components throughout it. Even if we go all the way back to where we were looking inside the chip, I'm not gonna go all the way back, but they actually had a little tiny heat sink inside the processor. So even inside there, they'll have little heat sinks, you know, placed to help disperse the heat as much as possible from those units as they heat up. Now for a CPU, those generate a lot of heat. So they can't necessarily rely just on passive cooling in order to help keep them cool. So this is where the passive cooling is, the heat sinks. And then they will typically take this and apply it directly to the CPU using the all-important thermal paste. And we had a TA who forgot to do this, fried a processor, and had to rebuild the computer because of that. But as a reminder, to make sure that they never forgot to do it again, they still have the original thermal paste packet from that CPU build that he forgot to put on the CPU. So he keeps that as a reminder not to fry his computer another time. The majority of the time on a CPU, you will see this combination. You will have a heat sink set on there, and then they will put directly on top of that a case fan that will blow air down through that heat sink and disperse that heat at a much faster rate than just using a passive method where you would only see the heat sink on top of it. That is the most common way that they use to cool a CPU currently. There are different ways. So we also have the submersible system, where you're literally taking the entire computer and submerging the entire computer down into mineral oil. It is probably the most effective of any method we have of keeping a computer system cool. It's non-conductive. It dissipates the heat very, very quickly. Looks kind of cool and works very well. However, it is very, very expensive to keep up with, because much like a car, you do have to change that oil on a regular basis, and it is a very expensive method of cleaning. Yes, maintenance is a mess, which is why it is not very common you would see it, but it is a method that people use. People do still use it from time to time. You search, you know, Google for different images of submersive systems and stuff like that, and they have some pretty cool setups that they have put together. One of the more common systems you will see today, less common than the actual just heat sink and fan, is a liquid cooling system, where they will actually, you know, apply a plate directly to the CPU that will run a liquid through it. And then it will attach to an actual radiator, similar to what you have in your car. And it will run that liquid through. As that liquid heats up, it will be pushed into the radiator, be dispersed throughout the radiator to help dissipate the heat out, and then circulate back through into the cooling system. And they operate off of a pump to continually move that liquid around. Problem is when these stop functioning, if you're not paying attention to it, much like anything else, like if a fan stops running, it's noticeable because you don't hear that fan. Your computer's overheating and you hear that fan. With the liquid system, they are much quieter. So when that pump stops working, kind of like in your car, if the water pump stops working, what happens? Your computer starts overheating really quickly, but you don't have that audio indicator that, hey, the fans aren't working. You know, my cooling system might not be there. You just may think that, my computer's acting up a little bit, and you continue on and you can end up burning out your processor. Yes, TJ.
I've actually never once heard or seen of a submersible system before. How are they keeping all that? How are they keeping all the equipment inside there safe?
Great question.
Well, it's using mineral oil, not water. It's non-conductive, right. So it's not allowing an electrical charge to jump from one piece to another. So it's not damaging the components. And, you know, say if you wanted to take a like a garden tool or some kind of metal and you wanted to prevent it from rusting, what would you do? You would actually coat it in a thin coat of oil so that it would prevent oxidation, so that it wouldn't rust or degrade that component. This is a similar thing, but you're submerged, you know, like you're putting the whole thing in like a whole bucket of oil rather than just kind of coating those components in oil, those connector pieces, those metal pieces, the copper, the gold, or whatever. So it's not going to allow the charge to jump from one to another, and it's not going to allow rust or any other kind of issue to corrode the components. So it's basically in a protective casing, but you still need to, over time, change the oil and keep up with the general maintenance on it.
All right, I understand. Thank you.
No problem. So, all right. Sorry, any questions with regards to the different types of cooling?
Kelly, I think we need to give them a break.
Oh, yeah, okay. Before we jump into, well, let's ask any questions on the different types of cooling. If there are no questions, take a quick 10-minute break. Okay. If there are no questions, meet back here at...
Recording.
All right. On to the steps for removing and installing CPU. So, without even getting into it and looking at it, what's step one? Anybody?
Our always
plugged
PC.
Always step one.
Unplugged PC.
What else?
And take out all the charge from the capacitors by pressing down the button.
What would you do before you unplug it though? Just to be nice.
Turn the power off.
There you go. Turn it off. Don't just snatch the cord out if it's on. So yep, power it down, unplug it. Hold the power button for 5 seconds to disperse the charge in the capacitors. Always step one. So obviously the new processor, you want to keep that in, you know, I would suggest keeping it in the box that it came in, you know, not just the anti-static bag, just keep it in that actual box to make sure it is as protected as possible before you take that thing out and put it into the computer. So we're going to power it down, 3 to 5 seconds to disperse the charge. Then we're going to remove the side panel either with that clip and slide out or a couple screws and remove that side panel so that we have access to the actual motherboard itself. And then we are going to remove the heat sink. And if it doesn't come off easily, if it comes off easily, it probably means your thermal paste is very, very old and needs to be replaced. If it does not come off easy, take some dental floss, non-wax, slide it through and slice it and be able to open it up, remove your old CPU, put that one into an anti-static bag, especially if it's one you're going to want to use later, maybe resell it, what have you. That will keep it protected. And then obviously take note of the thermal paste condition. Most CPUs have the arm that locks and secures it in place, that ZFI system. Make sure to unlock that, open it up before you remove the socket, and it should gently and easily come out. If you're needing to require a bunch of force to get it to remove it, you've probably missed the step. So be careful with that. Nothing should take a lot of force when you're working inside of a computer. Everything should, you know, kind of slide in and out of whatever components with relative ease. I think one of the main exceptions are with RAM. You get it seated, and then you're going to apply a little extra pressure to make sure that the wings lock in place. But you want to make sure it's evenly distributed and make sure it is inserted properly in the right generation so that that notch isn't in the wrong place. If it's rocking and refusing to sit in there levelly, you probably have the wrong type of ram and the notch is not lined up properly. All right. See, Chris, can you read for us real quick?
When removing the old CPU, take extra care to hold only on the edges, protecting the pins from being bent. Then store inside the ESD bag. Remove the new CPU from its bag, being careful to hold by the edges. Look carefully at the socket to locate an indicator as to which direction the CPU will sit. Some have a red slash yellow arrow slash triangle that matches up to the CPU, which others may have notches that will align. See pictures, for example.
Excellent, thank you. So based on what we were talking about with proper procedure, with removing and placing chips, is this picture an accurate representation of what you should do? Think back to T1 when we were talking about, or T2 when we were talking about tools, safety procedures, and stuff like that.
As you see, he has it.
Go ahead, Avery.
Yeah.
He should be using the little clipper things to pick it up.
Exactly. That's what I was getting at. You can do it with your fingers, but you're going to have more precision and going to be less inclined to actually drop it. Plus, you don't run the risk of getting your oil from your fingers on the chip if you use the actual tool for this.
Yep.
Good job. All right, now once the chip is in place, we're gonna lock that arm of the ZIF. That cage is essentially gonna go over and lock it in place. And then absolutely going to apply thermal paste. And only about as much as a pencil eraser, just a little dollop. If the heating, the cooling element you're gonna be putting on there does not already have it applied, you don't want to double cover necessarily because it could get too much and then ooze out over the edge of the chips and actually cause damage. So be sure to check before you apply it. If you're using a new cooling, like a heat sink or liquid cooling or something like that, it usually is already pre-applied with more recent versions. Any questions so far? Now, we're pretty much in the home stretch at this point. After you've put the thermal paste on it, you put the heat sink back on top, or if you're using liquid cooling, the cover that would go over, you would place that on there as well, and then secure the radiator inside the computer. But this, you would put the heatsink back on, and then you would attach the fan on top of the heatsink. And as we talked about yesterday and probably the day before, you don't go in a circle when you're screwing down the screws. You go in a cross pattern to ensure even distribution of weight so you don't damage the CPU underneath it and apply uneven pressure to the actual unit. Then you're essentially in the home stretch. You connect the fan for the CPU fan to your motherboard. There's a 4-pin connector from the power supply that you will connect to the motherboard that will power the CPU. Then you go ahead and close the door on the computer, power it up, and hope it actually works. So.
And that's kind of the same that you'll do in reverse to take it back out. Anything out of the ordinary came out of this, or if you're following along, everything's pretty much how we talked about it, I'm sure.
A lot of the steps are similar for each of these processes because it's, you know, you're using the same safety procedures. The initial steps are pretty much the same. It's just the level of depth that you're going into the actual computer and then coming back out. But even if you're going in there just to do RAM, which is one of the simplest things, or one of the absolute simplest things, is replacing a CMOS battery. So if, even if you're going in there just to do something very small like that, check and make sure your RAM's seated properly. Make sure the heat sink seated, you know, is seated properly on the CPU. You know, just do some basic checks, blow dust out of there. If you start to see the vents getting clogged, because you want to make sure you're maintaining good airflow so that everything stays nice and cool. Check all your connectors, make sure they're sitting there. You know, it's just basic maintenance and it will help prevent problems down the road if you just do those quick little safety checks. All right, got a quick video. Should play on all devices.
Got to share that sound, or can you guys hear it on your own? I didn't think so. Stop right quick. Zoom got to come up with a better way for you to share sound without having to unshare and reshare to do it. They got to figure that out. That's a simple request.
Hi there, this is Ranjit from tech2bass.com, and in this video we're going to install Intel processor on this motherboard. And the motherboard that you're seeing is an ASUS motherboard based on the Intel Z77 chipset. And this supports both the Sandy Bridge and the Ivy Bridge chips based on the LGA socket 1155. And I'm going to use a LGA 1155 chip on the same. And the general thing before attempting to do something like this is that you notice this is the motherboard. And the thing that you have to keep in mind is any static electricity that you might have built up should be dissipated before even you touch the motherboard, because it can damage the motherboard. So I suggest wearing a anti-static wristband or grounding yourself before attempting to do the same. And for this test, let me move the motherboard. I'm using a stock Intel kit in which we get this CPU cooler and the chip itself. And if you take out the CPU cooler, as you see, the thermal paste is already pre-applied. So I'm not going to apply the thermal paste here. But if you're using an aftermarket air cooler or something like that, you might need to apply the thermal paste on the chip. And this is the actual motherboard. Let me just zoom in a little bit, because this is the area where we're going to work. And the first thing you do is gently press this and move this and open this latch, and this latch will open this way. And now you need to open the processor that you have. Do notice that this is the processor and you should not touch this area. Gently lift it, and let me just move the motherboard and let me show you one more thing that is a little bit important. Let me see. If you notice here, you can see these two notches, and on the socket of the motherboard also you'll have similar two notches. Let me break the motherboard now, and as you can see, here are the two notches. So, and we also have an arrow over here, and we have an arrow on this. So you just gently place the chip and it should sit down. And now what you have to do is bring back this plate like this and depress the lever. Do note that you might have to apply a little bit of pressure. That is okay. Now you have installed the chip. Now what you have to do is, now we are going to install this fan on the same. And to do that, it's also pretty easy. Let me show you the motherboard actually, let me just zoom out a little bit. And if you notice, we have these four holes over here, and our stock Intel cooler will mount there. And let me just zoom in a bit so you get a better view. And what we do is we gently place this over here, over the four holes approximately. And those four pins should just go down gently. And now what we do is hold on to the processor like this and just depress. And you'll get a clicking sound. And do the same for the next one and proceed with the others. You should get this clicking sound that you have heard. That means we have fixed the CPU cooler. And now the last thing that we need to do is, let me show you the same. Your motherboard should have a header like this, known as the CPU fan. And you now just need to attach the CPU fan. And that's it. And that's how you have installed your CPU on your motherboard. And let me just turn the motherboard. 1 second. And if you look at the back, I want to show these tiny pins. They should come out. That means you have successfully properly installed the stock Intel CPU cooler. So that's how you actually install Intel CPU on a motherboard. And in my next video, I'll be installing the other components like RAM, connecting the actual SMPS to this motherboard, and we're going to power it on. So stay tuned to my YouTube channel for that. If you aren't subscribed, hit the subscribe button. If you found this video helpful, I'll appreciate if you click on the like button again below. That's it for now. This is Ranjit from tech2buzz.com, and I hope to see you in my next video.
Say that out loud, Jackie.
Those videos, man, they be off the chain. I love them. I was watching some yesterday and I was like, man, I can do that.
Those HGTV videos also make you feel like you can build a house, you know? Just like, yeah, oh, just buy a bad house in 2 weeks, you ready to flip it. No, it's a lot more go into it, you know? But he did do a really good job of presenting it and showing you how it works. My only concern, and also Kelly mentioned it in the picture, he was holding that processor, that CPU, very willy-nilly, just holding it all around like, man, just put it down till you're ready to use it, because that made me nervous. But other than that, he did a really good job. And correct me if I'm wrong, Kelly, that fan header can also allow you to control the speed, right?
Yes, a lot of times with the fan header, sometimes you'll see two pins, sometimes you'll see three. If you have a three-pin connector on your fan, but only two pins on the actual header, you can still connect it. You just connect it anyway, because one pin would be for power, one pin would be for on and off on the fan. Typically, if you see that third pin is speed. So They may ask a question along those lines. If you have a three-pin connector and there's only two pins for the fan, what do you do? And they'll ask, do you get an adapter? Do you, did you select the wrong motherboard? Something along those lines. But the quick and dirty answer is you just connect it. It just won't be able to control speed. It'll just be on or off.
Right. That's it.
So the other thing, like when they're showing a lot of these videos, I love it because everything that they're working with is nice, crisp, and clean. No hint of dust or anything like that. And typically in IT, that is not what we're working with. It's much like when you watch, if you ever watched a car repair show or something like that. It's like they have all the room in the world to work, you know, like we have to replace this header on this engine. So to do that, we remove the entire engine from the car and we have it just dangling here so we can walk around it and have all the room we need to work. When in real life, when you're doing that, you've got about 2 inches worth of space and you're trying to get all those tools in there and get it working properly. And it's just not the same thing and does not operate easily. So, and they also tend to do nice little jump cuts at important junctures where they could give you a nice little tip on how something would move, work smoother. Same, unfortunately, operates in IT videos when they're showing you. So, pitfalls to installing chips. Old pin grid array processor is stuck. Too much force might cause some of the pins to break off inside the socket of the motherboard as you're removing that old processor. This is partly why we were saying, like, if you're removing that heatsink off of the top, you don't use a twisting motion because you don't want to twist the actual processor and start snapping off pins. But unfortunately, in real life, some of this stuff happens anyway. Regardless of how many precautions we take, pins can break off because they, like I said, they're about the size of a human hair. They are very, very tiny and very fragile. So when something like this happens, use a pair of tweezers to try to pull the pin out. Obviously, before you start reaching in there with tweezers, make sure you have your ESD bracelets. And just as a double check for myself, I'll tap the tweezers on the side of the frame of the computer just a couple times just to be double sure that there's no residual charge or whatever. And then I'll reach in and go ahead and pull those extra pins out. Thermal paste has fused the CPU to the heat sink. I believe we went ahead and went over this one. It says slowly and carefully twist the heat sink to dislodge, but better option, use that dental floss. Go ahead and use that to slide in between the two and kind of cut across it. And that gives you a much better release on it. And it's not a bad thing just to keep in your bag. You just buy a cheap old spool of it, non-wax, and just throw it in your tool bag. And it's just something you keep on hand, you know, if you ever need it. The arm holding the land grid array CPU socket won't latch. Make sure, go back, double check, make sure you have seated that chip properly. It's not bumped up, sitting on anything, and not able to make full connection, because that would prevent the door from fully securing. And then, you know, just double check, make sure your triangles are matched up. So pin one's matched up with pin one, whatever indentations are cut out, those are matched up. And then reattempt and you should be able to secure it with little issue. Otherwise, if that is still not going, there might be the arm for the cage when you're opening it might've gotten hit and bent a little bit. So you need to check that. Or the other issue may be you don't have the actual right chip version. Questions so far? Yeah. All right, common CPU problems. They rarely, if ever, have actual mechanical problems aside from like manufacturer's defaults, and those actually can be catastrophic. But some issues may come up, usually intermittently, or just from time to time. And it's usually due to overheating or something along those lines. So you have like the heat sink malfunction. If it's not, the thermal paste isn't put on there properly, or it's not evenly distributed, or it's older and it's become chalky and breaking up, then the heat sink won't be doing its job. The processors will start to overheat, and this will gradually start to occur over time. And then could cause the computer to start crashing and things like that. Also may have intermittent communication issues with the actual motherboard. If it's catastrophic, obviously the system won't boot at all. It may send you straight into BIOS because that's all it can talk to. So diagnosing these issues typically would come with a postcode or something along those lines if it's not able to speak to the computer. You have anything to add, possibly, Marvin?
No, sir.
Questions? Any questions?
I was about to ask any questions? Concerns? Do you feel now empowered to remove or install a CPU? I should see a lot of nods. There we go. Amber? Yep. Okay. That's what I like to hear.
I thought there was a matching exercise with this, but I think we didn't have it on this particular one. But we will get into it a little more. Throughout the course of this technical session, you should be able to describe the various types of processors, be it Intel or AMD, how to select one, how to match them up with the appropriate CPU socket, explain the purpose and requirements to keep it functioning, choose an appropriate cooling method for what you are trying to do. Just as we know from standard use, typical office use, a heat sink and fan will typically get you where you need to be. Heat sink alone will not be enough if you're going to be using much heavier processing power, such as doing heavy graphics design, 3D rendering, gaming, things of that nature. You're probably going to want to upgrade your cooling system to include more case fans and or liquid cooling. Or if you want to go all the way, you could do submersive cooling, but it is a huge hassle and a lot more expensive. But you will have zero cooling issues. We should also be able to know the steps for replacing and installing a CPU processor, understand some basic common issues with installing it, and then a few symptoms if the CPU is failing and or if we have broken pins, something along those lines where we're getting intermittent issues due to bad connections. Any questions thus far? All right. Well, go ahead and stop the recording.